Morning Living the Word Church, I am so excited to be in your presence on today. Although I am still across the pond, I'm so pumped up about technology and how I still get to be in your presence and help us walk through what I believe is a critical area of your faith. So welcome to Living the Word Church, and thank you for being a part of our worship services on today. Today, I'm going to be discussing what it looks like to weather the storm of doubt. I want to give you a couple of things. As we have been discussing over this past summer, these various nuances of our faith, I need to let you know that our faith is going to constantly be challenged as we grow and mature. We're going to get hit by storms. We're going to get sidetracked by distractions. And I want to help you stay focused in the midst of the fight of faith. Do I have any witnesses here that's willing to be focused in the midst of the fight of their faith? Because it's so easy to get off track. Today, I want to give you the snippet of narrative that Jesus gives to us concerning a father who was at his wit's end with his baby boy. He came to the place of doubt. He came to the place of struggle. He went to the right source. He was close, but he wasn't close enough. I want to bring to your attention the realities of the storms of life. I want to give you the scripture text that I believe will help us further our conversation out of the Gospel of Mark. And here is where we'll begin our reading out of Mark, the 9th chapter, verses 14 through 29. It's a little much, but just trust me, as we go through this story, this narrative, it will help us to begin to weather some of the most difficult times of our life. It reads these words. When they returned to the other disciples, they saw a large crowd surrounding them. And some teachers of religious law were arguing with them. Of the men in the crowd spoke up and said, "Teacher, I brought my son so you could heal him. He is possessed by an evil spirit." Now, don't let that shock you. It shows to us and it displays that this father is at his wit's end. Something has entered his child. He says evil spirit. Jesus affirms such. Goes on to say, "He is possessed by an evil spirit that won't let him talk. And whenever the spirit seizes him, it throws him violently to the ground." Now, here's where it gets murky. "So I asked your disciples to cast out the evil spirit, but they couldn't do it." He says to them, Jesus, "You faithless people, how long must I be with you? How long must I put up with you? Bring the boy to me." They brought the boy, but the evil spirit saw Jesus. It threw the child into a violent convulsion, and he fell to the ground, writhing and foaming at the mouth. "How long has this been happening?" Jesus asked the boy's father. He replied, "Since he was a little boy, the spirit often throws him into the fire or into the water, trying to kill him. Have mercy on us and help us if you can." Verse 23, Jesus gets very personal and offended to some degree. He says these words, and it's very powerful. "What do you mean, if I can?" Jesus asks. "Anything is possible if a person believes." The father instantly cried out, "I do believe, but help me overcome my doubt." Oops, it says unbelief. We're going to talk about that in a few minutes. Jesus saw the crowd of onlookers was growing. He rebuked the evil spirit. "Listen, you spirit that makes this boy unable to hear or speak." He said, "I command you to come out of this child and never enter him again." Then the spirit screamed and threw the boy into another violent convulsion and left him. Jesus took him by the hand, helped him to his feet, verse 27, and he stood up. Afterward, when Jesus was alone in the house with his disciples, they asked him, "Why couldn't we cast out the evil spirit?" Jesus said these words, "This kind can only be cast out by prayer." I want to share with you all some thoughts. First of all, we get a graphic introduction into the life of a father who was at his wit's end. He had no other options. He had heard of the testimony of Jesus, had heard the miracles of Jesus. His boy was possessed with an evil spirit. Brings the boy to this, what we'll call, aura of Jesus. He didn't quite get to Jesus. He went to what was closest to Jesus, which the scriptures tell us were his disciples. Brings his boy who was in a condition and a malady that no one could solve but the miraculous power of God that Jesus proclaimed to have. Brings his boy to his disciples and nothing happens. What do you do when you've done everything in your power to do what God has called you to do and to be in the place God has called you to be? You have done your part and you get to the place where you're now waiting on heaven to do its part and there is nothing. See, I need to share with you all, it is in those moments, it's in those gap moments that really, that real warfare takes place and that we're really tested to see if our faith really is that of a genuine faith. And I'm here to tell you all, I have been in those gap moments. Those moments cause us to all wonder, God, what have I gotten myself into? What have I done? Where am I? I need to share with you all, we all have doubts. Everyone in the Bible that God used, everyone, you got to hear me, had doubts. When you look at the life of Joshua and God speaking to him, do not fear, do not fear. He's saying do not because fear was present. Believe me because doubt was present. You have to understand that doubt does not mean you are an unbeliever. It means you are human with struggles and you're seeking and asking God to do what only God can do. If you could have solved it, you would have solved it. But God has a way of letting us get into gap moments, not to dismiss us, but to bring us closer into the story of faith conquerors. Today, it is my purpose to arrest doubt. My purpose is to expose its consequences so that you can flip doubt on its head and walk in faith. There are four truthful realities about doubt in this particular text that I want to deal with, and I believe it will help us to start seeing what doubt does. The first thing I want to expose as a truthful reality about doubt is this. It's easy to have faith on the mountaintop, but it is hard not to doubt in the valley. See, it's easy to have faith when you are on the mountaintop with Jesus and you're close to him. It's easy to have faith, but when you walk back down into life's valley, into the valley of the real world, it's hard not to doubt. It's easy when we're together on Sundays and we're worshiping and we're magnifying God and we're singing songs of praise. It's easy for us to talk about how big our faith is. We even have songs that says our God is big and we have songs that God is able. But when we walk into the reality of our world on Monday, that doubt kicks in. That valley moment causes us to wonder, God, where am I and what have I gotten myself into? It's easy to have faith on the mountaintop. But when Monday rolls around and you're at work and all the problems of family begin to arise or the doctor's appointment didn't quite go as planned, that's when the doubt starts to kick in. The second reality and truthful reality that I want to share with you is doubt is a sign there is a broken connection with God. It is like a red flashing light. It is the stop sign. It is the caution sign. It is those men at work sign that says, be careful, go slow. Something is out of whack up ahead. You see, it's that red flashing light. It's that warning sign to you that there's something wrong. Something is broken. Jesus even goes to his disciples and he shares with them. He says, why couldn't you all cast out the doubt? Why couldn't you all cast out the devil? And Jesus makes it clear. He says, because you all did not have faith. I don't know exactly where you are in your faith walk. I don't know exactly what you're dealing with on this morning. I don't know exactly what fights you walked into this building with, but I'm here to tell you that when doubt is present, it is a sign that there has been some disconnection from God. The third truthful reality is my doubts limits God's power in my life. Let's just be honest about it. You cannot be faithful and doubtful. Something has to give way. You cannot conquer the giants and yet fear those giants. See, the father turned to Jesus and said, if you can do this, you can heal my son. And Jesus turned around and said to the man, if I can. No, he says, I can do all things. He says, if you can believe me, I can do anything you ask me. Anything is possible if you believe. So the man had an issue with his faith. He was saying, Jesus, I think you can do this. So go ahead and help me out. Jesus flips it around and he says, hold up. If I can, I know what I can do if you can just believe me. See, our part in the process of eradicating doubt, walking in victory, and weathering the storms of life is not if God can, it's if we can believe that God can in the moment we're in right now. See, I'm gonna tell you right now, doubt is the thing that causes us at least to trigger our faith or to trigger more doubt and fear. See, when I'm in the place of doubt, either I'm going to get more doubtful or I'm going to square myself up and say, okay, God, I'm having a hard time, but I still trust you. I still believe you. And that's what I want you to get to the place of maturity that says, God, it's tough right now, but I trust you in the long run. The fourth reality is this. Jesus only requires a small amount of faith. Listen to the Father's prayer. If you can, I believe, but help my unbelief. So he begins it by saying, if you can, Jesus. Jesus flips it around and says, I know I can if you just believe. The Father then responds and says, well, I believe, but help my unbelief. In the midst of this wonderful discourse, Jesus then goes on to tell his disciples who were asking the question, why couldn't we cast the devil out of this boy? Jesus says, if you just have faith as a grain of a mustard seed. Mustard seed is one of the smallest seeds out there. But then Jesus doesn't just say mustard seed faith. He says the grain of a mustard seed, the smallest particle of faith, will cause miracles to happen. This father understands that in the midst of his doubt, he has enough faith to yet trust God. He says, okay, I believe, but help my unbelief. The fifth truth that I want to bring to your attention is this. The essential tool to overcoming doubt is prayer. The essential tool to overcoming doubt is prayer. You see, the disciples were confused. Why couldn't we deal with this boy? Why couldn't we handle this issue with this little boy? We've been able to heal in the past. Why couldn't we heal this boy now? And Jesus said, this kind can only be healed by prayer. See, there was no doubt that the father had doubt in his petition. It was obvious that this father struggled because he said, help my unbelief. Can I tell you all something? Can I pause for a moment? When you come to God, even with the knowledge that you're doubting, that's still called faith. Because you're saying, I'm coming to you. I have no B plan. You are it. I trust you, although I have my doubts. This father is highlighted in scripture because it shows us you and me. That was doubt. Look what he says. Have mercy on us and help us if you can. What do you mean, if I can? Jesus asked. Anything is possible if a person believes. The father instantly cried out, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. Help me overcome what I'm struggling with. The disciples couldn't do this. But if you can do this, if you can do this from us, is what the father was saying. He says, I went to your disciples. They couldn't help me. But if you can help me, and I'm here to tell you all, and we'll talk more about this in a few seconds. When people fail you, God doesn't. I know that sounds crazy. We oftentimes get mad at God's church because the church doesn't respond in the way we think the church ought to respond. But the truth of the matter is, if we go to God, he will quell all of our fears. He will massage all of our aches, and he will heal all of our wounds. So now let's flip doubt on its head, and let's talk about on today. I want to talk about how to overcome doubt through prayer in three areas of our lives. Area number one, when difficult circumstances causes doubt, my prayers release God's power into my life. My prayers release God's power into my life. Why is that? Remember, Jesus says some things cannot come out except through prayer and fasting. So when I am in a difficult circumstance that causes doubt, my prayers release God's power into my life. Facing difficult circumstances is going to be a part of our life. This is one of the biggest reasons why we often doubt God, because we're going through a difficult time. It's making us uncomfortable. We're feeling inconvenienced. You know, I'm gonna tell y'all something right now. Sometimes doubt is our first response to tough times. Think about it. When we're going through life's adversities, the first response often is, God, what did I do wrong? Why aren't you blessing me? Why am I going through this? Did I mess up somewhere? Where's your power at this moment? Sometimes doubt can be our first response to tough times. Maybe we are dealing with a sickness. Maybe we have a loved one that we just lost, or a marriage that's enduring tough times. Those difficult circumstances surround us and doubt creeps in. We begin to think, God, where are you? God, why have you allowed this to happen to me? And y'all, don't get it twisted. Some of you all are in the audience right now and you are wondering, why am I in this posture right now? God, do you really love me? It happened in our story with this father. See, when you think about the father and his son, the Bible says in Mark 9 that the son is possessed by an evil spirit and it won't let him go. In verse number 17 and 18, it says these words: he is possessed by an evil spirit that won't let him talk. And whenever this evil spirit seizes him, it throws him violently to the ground. That's enough to make you doubt. If you've ever been in a warfare of your faith and doubt, if you've ever been in spiritual warfare of any kind, that's enough to make you doubt. Why would God allow this to happen? This father was probably surmising. Why would God allow this to happen to my son? You see, doubt is how Satan wants you to respond to difficult circumstances in your life, because he wants you to stay in this place where you're constantly sliding back and you're getting further and further away from the very God that got you to where you are today. When a difficult circumstance or a tough time comes into our life, Satan's first step is to put doubt right between you and God and to use it as a wedge to drive you away from your relationship with God. I'm here to tell you all something, though. I want to tell you all, the enemy doesn't want you to rely on God. He wants you to get to the place where you start pouting and pitying yourself, and you get people around you who co-sign the pity. Listen, in those moments, I'm here to give you an answer. In those moments where you feel like everything is hitting you, the thing that gets you out, the thing that releases God's power is prayer. John Bunyan puts it this way: prayer is a shield to the soul, a sacrifice to God, and a scourge for Satan. James 5 and 16 puts it even better. He says these words: the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Look at that. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Can you just tell your neighbor that I won't stop praying? Okay, say it one more time. I won't stop praying. Look what Paul said to Silas as they were getting out of jail. It says about midnight, Paul and Silas were what? Praying and singing hymns to God. And the other prisoners were listening to them. See, I'm here to tell you all, in the moment of doubt, in the moment of struggle, in the moment when life is beating up against you, start praying. Paul shows it, James shares it, and Jesus displays it. That's when his power is released. Is when we connect to God in prayer. That's when his peace, his presence, yes, even his power comes in and helps us deal with the circumstances that we are going through. I want to share this with you in Mark 9 and 23. Look what he says. Anything is possible if a person believes. Do you believe? I don't know about you, but I've come to life's crossroads, and I've gotten to the place in my walk with God. It took me some time to get there, but when I get to that place where I feel disconnected, I say, God, even now I believe. The second way I want to help you, and the second circumstance I want to bring to your attention that causes us to doubt, is when imperfect Christians cause doubt, my prayers enable me to look past them to God's Son. I need to spend some time right here. In fact, I'm going to come off the pages a little bit to bring to you a couple of things the church is under attack in the regards that we're seeing people fail us. We're seeing people do some crazy things that call on the name of Jesus. We're seeing people in the church world respond to the world events without the heart of God, without scriptural convictions. And we're seeing people who once we celebrated, who we sang their songs, that they are saying some really crazy stuff. But I'm gonna tell y'all something. They're imperfect. They're not God. They don't represent the entire body of Christ. They are not who saved us, and they do not hold our salvation in their hands. See, when we look at the mirror, though, we see an imperfect person every day. So we ought not to get so focused on who said what and who did what. When we look in the mirror of our own lives, every morning we wake up, we see an imperfect person that's reflected in that mirror. In our story in Mark 9, I think about this father. He was scared. So he brought his son to the disciples to be healed, and they couldn't do it. See, I need to share with you all, if we were to somehow surmise and begin to see exactly who represents what crowd, Jesus, of course, stands by himself, the head of the church. The disciples represent the church. That's you and me. People who we are representing God, and we are those who are a call to go out into the world and preach the gospel. So sometimes the only thing people will see of Jesus is you and me. So the disciples represent Jesus. They represent everything Jesus stands for. They represent the miracles of Jesus. But they failed his father. This father is struggling. This father is tired. This father is wounded and weary. And can I talk a little bit about church hurt right here? Thank you so much. Because this father went to the disciples and they could do nothing for him. And the father tells Jesus on the church. He says, I went to them and they couldn't help me. Did y'all catch that? He tells Jesus on the church. He says in verse 18, I ask your disciples to cast out the evil spirit, but they could not do it. Can I talk church hurt right here? Because what happens when, what is the definition of hurt? Hurt ultimately means you've been disappointed, which led to you to maybe do something crazy, or you felt devastated because you had put so much faith in the Christian body to come through at the ninth inning. So here's what this father's doing. He says, my son is seized by a demon. He is fighting a spirit. And I went to the thing closest to you and they failed me. Church hurt is when your expectations are not met. Disappointment settles in. Disappointment leads to despair. Despair ultimately causes you to get into the place where you're despondent, you're doubtful, you're discouraged, and then life hits you real hard. My brothers and sisters, please understand this. This father was given an opportunity to be healed because he wanted his son to be healed. But I also believe he needed to be healed from church hurt. He goes to Jesus. In this particular, he goes to the head of the church. He says, I did try. They didn't help because they had doubt themselves. But Jesus answers all of this father's problems. First of all, he lets the father know, if you just believe me one more time, I got you. He then displays his power by healing his son. I want to encourage those that feel hurt, let down, somehow disappointed by the church, even leadership, which is going to happen because we're all flawed. We don't have this figured out. I love to tell you I have it all figured out. I don't, you don't, we don't. But here's the beauty. When we all come to Jesus, when we all have faith in God, when we all put our hopes in Jesus Christ, greater things can happen. I'm flawed, you're flawed, we're flawed, they're flawed. But together, when we put our collective prayers before God, something happens in the heavens into the earth. See, I know a lot of people who let their faith be shaken when someone who is a Christian or someone who says that they are Christian lets them down. I won't get too much into this, but I want us to go to Hebrews 12 and 2, and I want us to hear this. Here's what he encourages the church who was going through great persecution. He says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus. Not on the church, not on the choir, not on the deacon's ministry, not on the helps ministry, but let us fix our eyes on Jesus. If you constantly are putting more faith in mankind than you are in God, you will constantly be disappointed. The Hebrew pastor says, no. Jesus is the author and the perfecter of our faith. Not man, not mankind, not the preacher, not the bishop, not the pope, not the apostle, but Jesus is the author and the perfecter of our faith. When we fix our eyes on Jesus, look what happens. I'm going to just jump right to it. In the text of verse number 26, it says, then the spirit screamed and threw the boy into another violent convulsion and left him. Verse 27 is where I want to highlight. Jesus took him by the hand and helped him to his feet, and he stood up. Did y'all catch that? Jesus went to the boy. He commanded the spirit to come out the boy, went to the boy, picked picked him up, helped him stand to his feet, which says he restored this young boy's life. When you go to God, when you believe in Jesus, miracles do happen. You don't have to spend another day looking to your left, looking to your right. You don't have to have another pity party. You don't have to crack another bottle of drink in order to wash down the sorrows of life. You can go to God. God will answer prayers. And that's the point I'm getting over to you, is that doubts go happen. But in the midst of doubt, trust the prayers you prayed that God's going to release his power. Don't worry about who has failed you. Trust in the God who has never left you. Which leads me to my last point. When times of spiritual dryness causes doubt, my prayers allow me to hear God's voice again. All of us, at one time or another, are going to go through a time of spiritual dryness. It's a time where we don't feel God's presence. We feel like God is far, far, far away. We want to pray, and when we do pray, we don't necessarily hear God's voice or feel like he hears our voice. That's why it's called dryness. It feels like we are in a spiritual desert. Do I have a witness? A Christian author, Philip Yancey, wrote this: any relationship involves times of closeness and times of distance. And in a relationship with God, no matter how intimate, the pendulum will swing from one side to the other. See, I want to share with you all that you might feel like God is taking you through a desert right now. And you might feel like it's unfair, but God is taking you through this desert to make you stronger and to prepare you for whatever it is he has for you next. Listen, the times of dryness are going to come. There are going to be seasons where you feel the presence of God, and it's like the joy of the Lord truly is your strength. And there are going to be times where your walk with God is blah. What do you do? See, I need to share with you all, it is in those moments that your faith prior to your dry season has to come into effect. See, your feet have to be firmly planted in a life of prayer so that when God speaks to you, you can hear him, so that you'll be nourished. That's what the psalmist was saying in Psalms 1 and 3. He says, they are like trees planted along the riverbank, bearing fruit each season. Leaves never wither, and they prosper in all they do. Can I share with you all, in the times of dryness, in the times of struggle, in the times of sickness, in the times where you are dealing with the disappointment of a fellow Christian, have your feet firmly planted. Quit worrying about who's left, who's right, who's up, who's down. Have your feet planted so that when that season of dryness passes, you will still have, or should I say, when that season of dryness comes upon you, you will still have your roots in God. Let me give you a couple of thoughts here that I believe will help you. Jesus tells his disciples these words: I tell you the truth, if you had faith even as small as a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it would move. Nothing would be impossible. Can I implore you, can I encourage you that in the times of dryness, prayers still work. In the times of difficulty, prayers still work. In the times of struggle, prayers are still heard. Even though you don't feel it, even though you don't know what you're going to do about this, but when you pray, when you seek God, you invoke his presence and the miraculous happens. Can I get somebody to give God a shout right there? Because the miraculous is what we are seeking God for, because we've gone to our uncles, our aunties, our mothers, our fathers. We've gone to Big Mama. We've gone to people in authority, but they couldn't help us. But when we turn our attention to God, do I have a witness? When we turned our attention to God, stuff started to move. Things started to shift in the right direction. My body started to feel better. My mind started to regulate. My peace overwhelmed me. My joy became my strength. Do I have a witness here? That when we go to God in prayer, miraculous things happen. I feel excited here, all the way from Africa. I'm here to tell you that God will answer your prayers, that if you would just believe, come on, nudge your neighbor and tell your neighbor, I believe God. Tell them one more time, I believe God. I don't know about you, but there are moments I go through difficulties and doubts, but at the end of the day, I believe God. If that's you, if that's you, come on, Zion. If that's you, I need you to do me a favor. I need you to grab the person's hand you're standing next to or sitting next to. I need you to stand all over the house. I want to pray, because at the At the critical moments of life, when you leave this place, you're going to need something to walk with you. I want to pray with those who are struggling this morning. I'm going to encourage those who are fighting this morning to have faith. If you have them by the hand, let us pray. God, my God, I lift up my brother and my sister whose hand I'm holding, that you would give them strength, that you would help them in the difficulties of their doubt, that you would empower them to get through this season of dryness, that you would encourage them to go one step further with you. And those who are far from you, those who have disconnected from you, those who let life get the best of them, give them strength now, God. Help them to understand your power, your will, and your way. In Jesus' name we pray.